everybody. We might make a start. I'm sorry, we have started a bit later. I do realise at the end of a busy day, it's often hard to get here for a 6 o'clock start, so we're just giving a bit of a window for people to come. Welcome to the LSE Matrix seminar series, the latest in our series. Our host from Matrix, unfortunately, was detained, and so I'm from the LSE. My name is Devika Hovell, and I'm the co-organiser of this series. I don't have much information about fire exits, and I've got a whole lot of housekeeping issues. Jump out the window is all I can suggest. I'm afraid I don't have that information. On the other hand, I do have information about a wonderful panel and the seminar this evening. The seminar looks at what has now become a line of cases that looks into liability or liabilities, as it has become, of empire. We're going to focus this evening on the mature case, or what's known as the Mau Mau litigation, which has potentially spurred this series of cases that has followed, looking into liability for the conduct of colonial governments and the liability, namely, of the UK government for that conduct. According to Martin Day, who is the senior partner of Lee Day, that ran this litigation, the mature litigation, and this is just from a conversation with him. I'm not sure if it's true. I know we've got people from Lee Day here. It all started with a knock on his hotel room door in Nairobi at 10 o'clock one night when he was in Kenya on other business. Lee Day took up the claim of five elderly Kenyans and brought this claim to the High Court, seeking damages and a declaration of liability for the fact they'd allegedly been detained and tortured during the time of the British colonial administration in Kenya, and this was in the 1950s and 60s. There were two unsuccessful claims of summary judgment by the government in the High Court. Justice McComb heard these cases, and again, just anecdotal evidence, he loved these cases. He found them extremely interesting, and that's obviously from the luxurious position of being able to be fascinated in these claims that result actually from what he called appalling misconduct. But these two summary judgments were unsuccessful, and this led to a settlement in 2013 and a payout of £19.9 million to over 5,000 Kenyan victims of colonial torture. William Hague, when presenting notice of the settlement and also apology in Parliament, said that this was in full and final settlement of these claims. But of course, this was rather the beginning rather than the end of that litigation. Newspaper headlines since then depict June 2013, Batang Kali family press UK harder after talks of Mau Mau settlement. July 2013, slavery compensation. Caribbean nations proposed Mau Mau model. October 2014, 40,000 Kenyans accuse UK of abuse in second Mau Mau case. April 2015, Malawians seek compensation for Nyasaland massacre during British rule. We see this has truly opened a line of cases. It also comes at an interesting juncture in terms of liability for foreign torture. It's an interesting juncture, and again, Richard is involved in some of these other cases. But we've got the UK acting as prosecutor. We've got a quite interesting case against a Nepalese colonel in the Old Bailey at the moment, prosecuting him for torture in Nepal against Nepalese victims. So UK acting as prosecutor. But the UK is also in the dock. Of course, there's this claim of foreign torture and this question of the bloodline of torture, because we've also got current allegations against the government in the Belhart litigation that Richard's involved in, as well as in the Hooded Men case potentially being coming back before the European Court of Human Rights. And as I said, invites reflection this seminar on the legacy of torture and the role, if any, that litigation can and should play in any retrospective reckoning with torture. We have a quite phenomenal panel to speak to us about this. In the order in which they'll speak, Professor Caroline Elkins is joining us from Harvard University. Professor Elkins, and I'm sure many, if not all of you, are aware of her work, under two titles. The one I have is Britain's Gulag, but it's also appears, I think, in the American print as Imperial Reckoning, and was the winner of the 2006 Pulitzer Prize. Potentially, well, this work did lead to this litigation. It was the unearthing, and Caroline, apart from being Pulitzer Prize winner, is obviously the most patient woman in the world. As she says about her research, it was about looking for silences. It was really, she pored through archives and materials, let alone spent much time in Kenya interviewing, but basically through the documentary evidence, looking for the gaps, because there just simply weren't many documents. I can't imagine day after day sort of going into the archives and only very, very rarely coming up with a document, which she did. There were some that had been left in place. But in a very interesting twist, and I'd love to know the story of the day you found out about the discovery and the discovery process in the Batur case of these 300 boxes of documents by a diligent Foreign Office official, of the documents that had supposedly been burnt or sent back and then lost in the UK, that did have some of the more damaging evidence, not just in Kenya, but across the colonies. Liora Lazarus is here from the University of Oxford. Liora is an associate professor specialising in comparative human rights, comparative criminal justice, security and human rights. Her book on security and human rights, and she's got one forthcoming on, I do practice this with you on the way. Securing legality and juridifying security, don't forget it, forthcoming. That will is based on, I think, a grant as well and much research. But she has been working in a way and looking at the question of archives and law. Richard Hermer QC of Matrix Chambers was, I think, lead counsel in the Matua case. And so he can talk to us about the complications of litigating these colonial claims. Okay, and I look forward as well from contributions from, I know there's many of you who have been involved in the case and who have much to say about the case in the floor. So, without further ado, Caroline, over to you.
Thank you very much. First of all, thank you so much, Devika, for inviting me and my distinguished fellow panelists, Richard, who we spent a lot of quality time together, and Liora, also some quality time together in other ways, and in many ways, it's I think, quite reflective of my being sandwiched between the two of them, because in some ways this was sort of the production of various archives for me, and on the right-hand side, the trying to understand and make sense of some of this. And so I want to address my remarks today around the fact that I do think I'm an historian. I'm not a lawyer, I'm not a legal expert, and yet I think there are many very important ways in which the law and history and the archives intersect, and I think the Mau Mau case was very much one that turned on this triangulation between history, archives, and the law, and also the ways in which this particular triangulation intersected with another one, which I want to sort of make some broader points about in the end of my comments, and that is the modern state and empire and liberalism. And that's something that, for myself and as a historian, I'm very interested in, but it also speaks to some of the current cases as to why we continue to see the kinds of, if you will, cover-up, refusal in the Malaya case, of which was quite a stunning judgment that came out. And I'll come to some of those points at the end. In other words, the issue about the way some of these judgments, from a perspective of an historian, are coming down are not simply about cover-up, but they're also something much more pernicious and ideological that's been at the root of empire and thinking about imperialism and archives for centuries. So to start on the history and the archives, I want to talk about the Mau Mau case and the production of Mau Mau history prior to the High Court case, and it was massive. Some estimate that only apartheid South Africa has produced sort of more historical writing, yet it wasn't until the publication, as Devika pointed out, of Imperial Reckoning, or we'll use Britain's Gulag since that was the title here in the UK, that we really had the first full account of the system of detention camps in Kenya in the 1950s. And not only the book reconstructs sort of the system and logic of the detention camp pipeline, it was called, that was the collective name of all the sort of 100 plus camps, But it also looked at the some 800 emergency villages, and it made claim that the violence and tortures and murders that unfolded behind the barbed wires of detention was systematic, and as well as overseen and condoned by British colonial authorities in London as well as in Kenya. In other words, I was making the case in the book that this was not a story of individual excesses or one-offs, if you will, though these, of course, did occur, but rather that, like the broader colonial project itself, violence was a state project in Kenya in different kinds of ways. And it's here that I'd like to turn specifically, which Devika gestured to the archives, both during my own research for Britain Schoolag and then in the case itself. Now, throughout my research, it was clearly evident that there were massive gaps in the official archives, both here in the National Archives at Kew, as well as in the Kenyan National Archives in Nairobi. And there was also sort of many oral testimonies from British colonial officials, among others, offering accounts of our archival destruction on the eve of decolonization. But still, as I said in Britain's Gulag, all good purges still leave something behind. And my role as an historian was to locate these ruptures, these disjunctures between the archival records and, if you will, the realities of British colonial violence that I had accumulated through sort of bits and fragments, as well as in particular through oral testimonies about several hundred in total. In other words, I was making the point then, which is going to be important in the context, at least from my perspective, and I want to be very clear that this is one particular person's perspective on the case as an historian who was involved as an expert, that there was clearly a deliberate state strategy of concealment and destruction and removal of evidence. Though at this point, as I said, I was less concerned about the why this had happened other than the fact that it was apparent that it did, and trying to understand the silences and the gaps in the record. Now, unquestionably, in my mind, the most important document to my work, and also an important document later in the case, resided at the National Archives in Kew, which I located in 1998 when I was a very sort of a graduate student with a lot of time on my hands. And as Devika explained, it was fairly depressing. You'd go day after day after day and you'd find just nothing. And in the back of my head, I'm hearing my advisor saying, I don't really have a topic, there's no... And then suddenly you'd come across something. And the one document that is, I think, probably one of the most significant, and I'll turn to the attorneys on the case to comment as well, but was a June 1957 secret letter from the Kenya governor, Sir Evelyn Baring, to the colonial secretary, Alan Lennox Boyd. And attached to this document was a memorandum from the Kenya attorney general, Eric Griffith Jones, and the memorandum was titled, quote, "Dilution, detention camps, use of force in enforcing discipline." Now, the dilution technique was central to the question for myself and my work of state-directed systematized violence in colonial Kenya. And Terence Gabahan was the colonial officer in charge of overseeing the development and execution of the dilution technique, both first in the Moya camps, and then these were extended to some other camps in the pipeline. And basically, the dilution technique was a technique that involved the isolation of small numbers of recalcitrant detainees who were manhandled, forced to labor, and otherwise, as one of Gabahan's underlings, John Cowan, said, harangued without respite, as he told me. And at the time, the British colonial government here in London was very aware, as it said in one of its responses, or in the documents, that a violent shock was associated, and they knew that detainees were dying as a result. The colonial office nevertheless approved of its use and continued to do so in the face of the knowledge of the detainees continued to die and that others were being tortured. And ultimately, Terence Gabahan was awarded an OBE for his efforts in these camps. Now, prior to the publication of Britain's Gulag, neither Terence Gabahan, nor the dilution technique, nor the creation and deployment of systematized violence in the detention camps had been subject of historical inquiry, despite the fact that there was this massive, as historians say, historiography, or a huge amount of literature on the period of Mau Mau. And alongside the June 1957 documents, I also amassed, again, as was gestured to, sort of hundreds of, sort of, you know, that chipping away, and the pile sort of grows like this, Of other documents that I found at Kew, as well as in the National Archives, in the Kenya National Archives in Nairobi, that remained extremely important in terms of supportive evidence. But in my own mind, sort of the key document that sort of linked a lot of this for me in the most decisive of ways was this June 1957 document, which, I'll be frank, I think just simply escaped sensitivity reviewers. It wasn't supposed to be there. And I got, as they say, kind of lucky in terms of that. Now, when the Mau Mau case was filed in the High Court in the spring of 2009, I often argue that history was very much on trial, with Britain's Gulag's revisionist history being in the dock, along with that of the other historical experts who are also on this case, David Anderson, who wrote Histories of the Hanged, and Hugh Bennett, who at that point had an unpublished doctoral dissertation but is now published. Now, I think it's important to point out, in particular, that Britain's Gulag was not uncontroversial, to say the least, in academic and broadsheet reviews. And I was impugned particularly for what was characterized as an over-reliance of oral testimonies, or the near absence of archival evidence. As I always said, I wish I'd had the 4 years back in my life that the reviewers said I didn't contribute to finding archival evidence. Uses of quantitative data, and also, in effect, sort of overstating my case. That, yeah, a few one-offs had happened, but this was, I had sort of really gone too far out there in terms of making the argument for systematized violence. And I should point out that in the academic world, amongst historians, the production of doubt, if you will, is very much part of the historian's craft. And there are, in fact, some academics who make an entire career out of producing doubt rather than actually analyzing credibility of revisionist evidence. And I like to say that this is, in part, very much a case here. And what becomes interesting are the ways in which the positivist lens of the High Court, where things are, academics and historians are very comfortable in the realm of subjectivity, right? The gray area, we're okay with that. What I came to learn as an historian is in the High Court, it's a fact or an act or it's not. I mean, it's just one or the other. But interestingly enough, this same positivist lens, which was used to critique Britain's Gulag, this revisionist history, was actually going to be truly deployed for, you know, in the High Court. So in effect, the High Court is determining both the validity of these claims, but in an odd sort of way, it's also adjudicating this big kerfuffle that has gone on in the academic world, whether or not what I wrote was fiction or not, right? Okay, for lack of better terms. Now, at the start of the case, my role was to provide expert historical input to the claimants and their legal representatives, and this included producing witness statements for what amounted to two, as was referred to, strikeout hearings, or the FCOs, or the Foreign and Commonwealth Office's attempts to strike out the Mau Mau case based upon legal technicalities. And what I want to do is to turn to each of these strikeout hearings sort of in brief. Now, the first strikeout hearing took place in April 2011, and my job was, as I understood it, twofold. And first, I was to produce what was, in effect, a kind of compressed version of Britain's Gulag, creating a kind of evidentiary framework and accompanying documents for the court on a range of points, including detention camp system, villagization, screening, abuses, torture, et cetera, et cetera. Now, importantly, I also had to produce documentary evidence that assisted the court in sort of parsing out questions about the colonial state. And it was very interesting because in this particular work, and certainly chime in if I'm off here, but the question about the colonial state is something that has long vexed historians as well and academics, because in many ways the colonial state is a state within a state, right? And it's the colonial state in Kenya is semi-autonomous in relationship to the state back, the sort of the mothership, if you will, back in London. And the ways in which sort of lines of authority will wax and wane depending upon particular circumstances, it, you know, happens over time consistently, not just in Kenya, but elsewhere. But what the court wanted us to do was to draw clear delineations of lines of authority. Who knew what, who gave the orders? And this becomes extremely important because what ends up happening is that the question about systematized violence, was this something that was devised, that happened sort of out there in Kenya, condoned, authorized by the colonial government in Nairobi, and this is important, acting in right of Kenya, versus to what degree were these actions either formulated, known about, condoned when the system of the violence ended up playing out, where the colonial government in London, acting in right of Britain, failed to stop it, right? And what becomes important in this instance, and this is where we sort of intersect but deviate in terms of historians and sort of legal practitioners, is these are important questions to me as an historian, but I'm not gonna lose that much sleep over it. These guys were losing a lot of sleep over it, right? And so and that's why I keep coming back to this 1957 document. This would be an example of where we intersect, right? Because it was, for me, that was enough evidence along with some of the other supporting material for me to make my claims in a book. These guys needed more than that, right? And so what becomes important is proving where liability rested, and it became the question of acting in right of Kenya or acting in right of Britain, and we had to demonstrate that what was going on here in London, they knew about this, and when they did know about it, they did nothing to stop it. So on top of this, and I always joke that, you know, I got done with all of this, what was a massive, you know, when I was sort of asked to do this, I'll be frank, I had no idea the amount of work that I was signing up for. And then Dan was always the best. He would sort of, I'd handed this big amount of work and he'd call up and say, Caroline, I have a favor to ask, and, you know, we're kind of on a tight schedule, and and the next thing I knew, I sort of handed in this witness statement. He says, well, we now have the FCO skeletal argument, and you kind of have to review it and pick it apart for all the historical inaccuracies. So that was one of my other jobs, is I had to sort of, along with the, obviously, Dan and others, also respond to the FCO skeletal arguments and identify where the points of historical inaccuracy. Ultimately, as we know, the claimants were successful in their first strikeout hearing, which centered on the question of state liability. And now the case moves forward in extremely important ways, not only for the claimants and the legal profession, but also for the historical profession and, frankly, the rest of the British Empire. Now, the second strikeout hearing focused on issues of statute of limitations. And the claimants, in theory, as many of you know, had 3 years to file their claims unless the judge decided to use discretion, and obviously 50 years had passed, and as Dan always said to me, this was a very, very high watermark of the case, and which it was. And so basically, sort of broadly speaking, two arguments had to be made, the first of which that the case could not have been filed prior to the 2005 publications of my work and David Anderson's. That's when the clock started, right? And secondly, that the British government could in fact have a fair trial, even with the decades having lapsed and many of the high sort of level officials either deceased or themselves incapable of testifying. And it's here where our work as historians took on a completely new and unanticipated dimension in the case itself. Just months prior to the first strikeout hearing, the British government, as I say, discovered, we're led to believe this was an administrative misadventure, there was no cover up here. After some 2 years of document discovery requests, 300 boxes of previously undisclosed files related to Kenya that had been packed up and spirited back at the time of decolonization. These were found at Hanslope Park, which many of you know is called Spook Central. There's MI5 and MI6 files there. And oh, just so happened that next to them, 8,800 files from 36 other colonies similarly packed up and spirited away were also sitting there. And now our job as historical experts, and I'll speak to my own work on this, and that I was charged with going through the Kenyan documents found at Hanslope Park to write an additional witness statement for the second strikeout hearing that took place in July of 2012. Now, this task, by any standard, was enormous. If I had gone through these documents in sort of the methodical way, it would have taken several years. We had about 9-12 months. I had a team of Harvard students working with me, and the documents were scanned, uploaded onto a searchable database, and of course the FCO had the right to cull these files, both for sensitivity and for relevancy before they're released to us, and I'm happy to discuss that more in sort of our discussion, but it made for a very frustrating process of trying to sort of unpack this evidence. Now, for the purposes of the case, there were hundreds of files that provided us with additional evidence of torture and cover-up, and to a more limited degree, evidence demonstrating that the British government, the connection back to sort of the government acting in right of Britain, these were crucial to the claimants in demonstrating that they had ample evidence for a fair trial. But nonetheless, there was no, at least in my own mind, there still wasn't the same kind of document that rivaled this. This 57 document, I sort of keep coming back to. And I keep coming back to it because there's often a lot written in the historical profession about how a single document can sort of change the course of things. And I think in this instance, our ability, or certainly my ability as historical expert, to read this other evidence that's coming in based upon our knowledge of this sort of one key link was very important. And then finally, I think from the perspective of an historian, and particularly this historian, and this is where we sort of converge and diverge, right? I mean, obviously in this case, in the context of statute of limitations, the legal team needed as much evidence as we could possibly provide of violence, right? And there was a lot of it in this documentation. At the same time, the FCO produced, for the first time ever, documents documenting the document destruction, right? All of this sort of oral evidence and surmising on the part of historians. And for me, it was like a bonanza. I mean, this was a sort of a treasure trove. And I think this is something that I'd sort of like to talk about for a moment and then make some final points. That prior to this, as I said, there was no, my view on sort of document destruction in Kenya is that this had to have been sort of a kind of haphazard process. What we came to learn, actually, is it was as highly systematized and choreographed as the actual violence that was perpetrated upon individuals in detention camps. And yet it was now, in this instance, perpetrated upon documents and the removal of evidence. To give you an example, in addition, that for each one of these, and ultimately within the documents themselves, it's estimated that 3.5 tons of documents were slated for the incinerators in Kenya. For each document, there was supposed to be a document destruction certificate produced to certify that a document was destroyed. Now, and I'll come back to this point, because one was to be left in Kenya, and there was a duplicate copy that was to come back to London for the official record here. Interestingly enough, one of the people overseeing this entire archival, if you will, process was not only then the chief torturer in the detention camps who won the OBE, Terence Gavahan, who was now in charge of overseeing the document destruction process on the eve of decolonization. So you can see how all this converges. Now, these become obviously very critical to both us as historians as well as to the case, because in some ways you sort of have to ask oneself, why on earth would all this be disclosed? And in some ways, you know, in American lingo, at least from my point of view, it was sort of the Hail Mary pass, right? Because the question becomes, why after all this time? This is a sort of a complete rupture in sort of issues with state secrecy, the retention of documents, long decades worth of hiding things. And the argument that was made in the High Court, which caused us all sorts of anxiety, at least me at the end, was that yes, in fact, these orders were given from London, but the Kenyan government, or the government, colonial government in Nairobi, acting in right of Kenya, went off the reservation and took the orders too far. And we never actually said they're supposed to destroy all this stuff. And so therefore, they, not us, acting right of Britain, gave the orders to burn all these files, and because they did that, we now can't defend ourselves. Now, what's interesting is now, law and history intersect, because as historians you have to take that argument and put it in the broader historical context as to when these documents were being destroyed. At the very same time that they're destroying these documents, they're lying on the floor of Parliament, they're evading independent investigations, they are dodging labor critics like Barbara Castle and Fenner Brockway, and so you have to believe in the context of all of this evasion that was going on at the end of Empire and the attempts to sort of sidestep any inquiries that really they didn't want the documents destroyed, not to this degree. And so obviously the alternative lawyers, but they made some very effective arguments around this. Ultimately, as we all know, the Justice McComb ruled in favor of the claimants in the second strikeout here in waiving the statute of limitations, starting the clock in 2005, not buying the argument about document destruction. And it's here, then, sort of in the last minute or two, that I'd like to make sort of one or two remarks by way of conclusion, which bring me back to some of these original points about history, archive, and law, and then sort of the nation state and empire and liberalism, which I think in some ways may tie into some other remarks. first of all, as I said, it was through the legal process of the Mau Mau case that, in fact, the revisionist history of Mau Mau was adjudicated on very positivist terms that the critics of Britain's Gulag purported in their own review of my initial findings. In other words, looking at this, Justice McComb, basically, by him coming out and saying things like, there's plenty of evidence that's coming out of these books to substantiate the case going forward, as he did in the first strikeout hearing, spoke directly to claims that if you took out the oral evidence in Britain's Gulag, the whole thing fell apart. It was an act of fiction, right? And I can speak to some more of that in the Q&A. At the same time, the documents found in the Hanslope disclosure, not only those from Kenya, but also the 36 other colonies, were released to the National Archives, they're now called the Migrated Archives, with incredible amounts of fanfare, public, and sort of these theatrics of self-discovery. I mean, the Guardian were there, the newspapers were touching the parchment of these old files. It was really quite something to see. But really what we've come to learn is this disclosure was a non-disclosure. There really are no smoking guns there other than the Kenya files, where we had the power of the court behind us in the release. And in fact, many, including the government's own official reviewer, Tony Badger, comments that the value of these sort of new migrated archives coming from Hanslope Park is the fact that they tell us a lot about the banality of bureaucracy in these various places. So as historians, we now confront the issue of writing about end of empire in particular in the face of massive archival erasure. Right, and this erasure pertains not only to the documents that were destroyed throughout the empire during decolonization, but they also pertain to what was left behind here in Kew. And I make this point before I turn to sort of nation state, empire, and liberalism, and that is going back to what I said about the document destruction certificates, where everybody kind of had a giggle about it. We should find it, and you should know that all archives, approximately 90% of all archival material are destroyed before it actually goes into the boxes, right? There's just no possible way archives can retain everything. But when you think about it, tens of thousands, at the minimum estimate, more of these document destruction certificates should have been sent back to London, which they were, and some of them, 2, 3, 10, 100, should have made their way into Kew into the National Archives. Prior to the Hanslope disclosure, and the release of the migrated archives, not a single document destruction certificate existed in the National Archives in Kew. In other words, what it tells us is those archives were culled too, right? And so that really presents a kind of crisis in end of empire writing, right? Because to know not only are these archives in the periphery highly sanitized for state-directed reasons, but so too is the main archive here in London. And then this brings me, I think, to my final points about the modern state, empire, and liberalism, because I think in many ways we can draw a reasonably straight line about colonial violence beginning with, and sort of cover up, and the uses of archives from the Warren Hastings trial in sort of the end of the 18th century all the way to the present day. And I think what we find is that there's a sort of a paradox between lived imperial experiences of the colonized and the laudatory claims of Britain's civilizing mission. And they can be traced to the conjoined birth in the 19th century of modern liberalism and imperialism, right? And so what we see is that it was sort of a moment where, or this paradox is one that internalized the contradictory impulse toward equality and liberal democracy as embodied in the nation state, on the one hand, and on the other, the exploitation and dependence in its colonial underbelly. Right. In other words, when you have liberal imperialism, they're two sides to the same coin, and they're mutually constitutive and formed at the same time in the 19th century. And when we think about sort of the birth of the civilizing mission and all that rhetoric, in fact, what we forget is that, and it all comes up during the Governor Eyre crisis and the Indian Mutiny, we actually have a birth and a shift that has an enormous amount of support for liberal authoritarianism that moves from the 19th century all the way through. And it's deeply imbricated and implicated in British national identity, particularly when we see an expansion of the franchise and the like, right? And so, and I can sort of give you all kinds of examples about this. But my point with this, and I'm going to end on it, is that is a bit where I began, and that is it's much more than just sort of controlling and manipulating archives for cover-up purposes to avoid legal claims. It's ideological. It's deeply ideological. And so the British government is never going to simply cough up all these archives, because it's an inherent threat to the British body politic. And there's nobody more threatening than the historical expert, right? They want to avoid us at all costs. And there were some battles in the case over the role of the historical expert. But it's very important to bear in mind, and I think this is where some of this comes together, why you're seeing rulings on various cases. Yes, it's about legal liability, but it's actually deeper than that. And if you think about it in that kind of way, you're coming up not against it. When you see the way in which the law is evoked, the law is one of many tools of liberalism. The law, the media, the academy, and it's not as though everybody's getting in a smoke-filled room and sort of, you know, working this out. It's ideological. It's deeply embedded. And until that shifts, you're not going to see a change in the kinds of things that we're discussing here. And I'll stop. Thank you.
Thank you. Liora, could I hand over to you as we ponder not just on, of course, the enormity of this damages claim, but the impact on our national identity?
So, I'm going to do an exercise, which is, I'm not an expert, I'm not an insider in these cases, and I'm surrounded by them. I come from the perspective of human rights law and national security law now, and just on the side point on liberal authoritarianism, yeah. It didn't end at the end of empire.
Yes,
but,
exactly.
what I'm going to do is I'm going to think big, and I'm going to think beyond founding legal claims, all right? So I want us all sort of stretch our legal imaginations. The first, I'm going to give you a few points. I won't take much of your time, but just to think through the implications of this case. The first thought that came into my mind was this relationship between historical truth and contemporary truth. So the KU and mature applications were about more than the establishment of individual responsibility, or the vindication of victims or relatives of victims and their rights. They were also about establishing the historical truth on the record. I'm tentative about the word historical truth, with Richard in the audience, but I will say something that historical truth for the purposes is actually a head of claim in this, and it's part of the language of the case. Now, in Matua, of course, the historical truth was at the core of the success of the venture, as it raised the prospect of a fair trial being conducted in the future, which itself was a key determinant in Justice McComb's decision to waive the statutory limitations to bringing the claim. In KU, however, the quest to establish historical truth served a more complex role. On the one hand, it undermined the Article 2 claim for Lady Hale, as a Strasbourg decision, Janowitz, had argued that the procedural obligation under the right against torture is not about broader historical truth inquiries, but about establishing criminal liability. As far as the common law was concerned, the quest for historical truth didn't appear to be sufficient for Lord Neuberger to view the exercise of the minister's discretion as disproportionate. But Lady Hale did argue that the value of establishing the historical truth should have been given more weight by the minister in her examination of the rationality test. What was striking for me, coming from a very different lens, was that in KU, there was no reference to the developing arguments surrounding the right to truth in the context of extraordinary rendition and the procedural requirements of Article 3. And this right to truth argument was incorporated into the language of the procedural obligation under Article 3 in El-Masri and was promoted with great vigor by the minority judgment by the judges in that case. And it's also been further developed in Al-Nasri in Poland and various cases, both as an individual right. But in Al-Nasri, they're picking up on the language of the UN Special Rapporteur, Ben Emmerson, that it's both an individual right and a public right to have the truth known about something. So my first question is, I wonder whether we can develop further discussion on why it is that historical truth and contemporary truth seem to have received different handlings in human rights terms. My second point is about secrecy versus accountability versus truth. So having said all this about contemporary truth or historical truth, I couldn't help wondering whether we now know more about the past atrocities than we do about the present ones around us. If there is anything that the Mau Mau and Batang Kali cases can show us, It is that deep secrecy lurks close where gross illegalities take place. They are lessons in the anatomy of secrets, how they come to light, who exposes them, why they are used to render accountability almost impossible, and how, if kept for long enough, they render retroactive accountability almost entirely impossible. I wonder whether we need to think more about the legal wrong in using secrecy to hide past or present illegality. There seems to be a focus in these cases on the question of whether facts that come to light are capable of triggering, a lot of triggering language in the case, triggering further inquiry, are capable of triggering a cause of action, triggering an exception to temporal restrictions on scrutiny, triggering a prosecution, or triggering some form of accountability. There's something upside down about all this. The onus is placed on the victim of rights abuse to demonstrate the factual accuracy of the allegation at great cost and difficulty. But there is less attention to the fact of secrecy and cover-ups themselves in these cases. And I couldn't help feeling all the way through KU, much less so in Mature, that somehow the benchmark was positioned too high, or the onus of justification was driving in the wrong direction. It isn't that the facts ought to be subjected to the test of whether a fair trial is possible. It should be made absolutely clear that the only reason a fair trial might not be possible is because the state has sought to keep the facts secret. It isn't that the fact of secrecy and cover-ups ought to constitute a factor in determining an inquiry that should be countervailed by other factors such as the likelihood of success in prosecution. The point is, secrecy is the problem in these cases. And again, I wonder whether we shouldn't be joining up the dots with cases like El-Masri and now like Nazar and Ghali against Italy. And here the Strasbourg court was clear that state secrecy was creating a culture of impunity, undermining accountability, and ultimately violating the investigative obligation under Article 3. And of course, the problem is that we are surrounded by increasingly strong acceptance and legal incorporation of secrecy as a mode of managing national security. And I'll come back to this later. My third issue was on temporality and this idea of retroactive accountability and future accountability. I got thinking that as I read these cases, that the question of temporal jurisdiction needs extending. We need not only to think about accountability for the past, but about accountability for the future. We need to be thinking of how these cases can demonstrate the basis for claims in 30 years' time. It seems to me that we are missing a trick somewhere here, that we haven't joined the dots. We need to know how the state's current recourse to secrecy and national security will become the subject of subsequent inquiry and checks. What is the state to make of its future accountability for wrongs, if the current signal sent out by the Supreme Court is that applicants, relatives of persons killed in cold blood, can find themselves ensnared in every temporal restriction on their claims? Temporal jurisdiction of the European Court of Human Rights, or the Human Rights Act, the 6-month time limit claims to application, the 2000 date, the high standards for what kind of evidence can shed new light to sidestep the temporal restrictions on bringing a claim, and the high standards on whether the evidence can stand the test of a fair trial. All this stands against potential applicants in the future. Clearly, if we withdraw from the European Convention on Human Rights, or we reject the idea that customary international law gives rise to a common law duty to investigate serious wrongs or rights violations, then there is even less disincentive to using secrecy now. And the more secrecy claims arise, and the stronger the claim that secrecy is necessary to security in contemporary contexts, the more we will need to develop structures of future accountability. The state should know now that the secret it holds will be scrutinized later, once the national security justification for such secrecy has diminished. So I propose that we start thinking more clearly about future accountability. We can't just let the Official Secrets Act time limits play themselves through. We need to insist that secrecy claims now based on national security become subject to future tests close enough in time to ensure the capacity for real accountability and ensure the possibility of vindicating the right to truth. Firstly, how do we do this? Firstly, there must be a human rights wrong, in the mere act of covering up material in bad faith, or using national security as a basis for secrecy, which is itself a veil to cover up illegality. If this is an extension of a human right, we need to think how it is grounded. It isn't just a question of public exposure. We need to have a human rights remedy or a legal ground established where the wrong of doing this is clear. Secondly, there has to be a duty of data retention, of an archival system for maintaining the records available to a court upon subsequent review. Tampering with such materials should constitute a clearly acceptable legal wrong. And this is what I imagine a duty of archival integrity needs to be established. Thirdly, we need to establish a time limit for when judicial or some kind of review of an initial decision to maintain a secret procedure, whether it's a closed material procedure or the use of a state secret doctrine, is permissible. If we are to learn from these cases, it is that these time limits cannot be too far apart, clearly. So I suggest 5 years as a starting point, with the possibility of rebuttal of closed material proceedings, if necessary. But that second procedure should be subject to subsequent review. So what I'm proposing here is an escalator of timed checks. Each review can assess all previous reviews until such time, and we can discuss the timing, that the presumption falls against the national security exception. Fourth, we need to think hard about the nature of evidence required to trigger a broader review of materials. Is it to be left to scholars, documentary makers, authors, whistleblowers, or leakers to create a weight of evidence which can convince a court or a minister that there are sufficient grounds to investigate further? Is this benchmark appropriate? And finally, we need to think about what test will be applied when we review for the second time, the third time, and the last time. What should apply? Was the initial material adequately reviewed in the closed material proceedings? Was the judge sufficiently rigorous in testing during those closed material proceedings? Was there bad faith in deploying a closed material proceeding? And finally, I just want to talk about the rule of law, retroactive accountability, and legal certainty. I just want to dispose of one point. On many occasions in this debate and in the case law, the conflict between legal certainty and retrospective accountability is often posed. It is interesting that this aspect of the rule of law seems to take precedence over other substantive values that the rule of law might impose. Accountability, or the right to truth, may be such values. But let's go back to legal certainty. What I would like to point out is that normally the arguments for legal certainty arise out of the idea that the citizen should be protected against the arbitrary actions of the state. It is far from clear how legal certainty provides us with a reason to protect the state from inquiries into its own previous or contemporary extralegal activities. And for that matter, I can't see that in these cases there is anything wrong with subsequent prosecution. We're not dealing here with a set of acts which are seen as legal. And anyway, if we create a system of future accountability, we would dispose of the problem that retroactive accountability conflicts with the idea of legal certainty and foreseeability. Thank you.
Thank you, Liora. Incredible. Very interesting ideas, which is why we like this seminar series. We bring academics to go with practitioners and not suggesting we've had big picture and now we're going to technical aspects. But yeah, looking at those big picture issues about what the rule of law entails, about archives, about and whether that can be achieved through litigation, this right to truth, I mean, that is emerging. Camilla's working on the right to truth at the moment as well. Whether that can be achieved through litigation or whether actually the historians are the ones that can help us with that.
Yeah, or both. I mean, this case might be an example of a synthesis between the two. Mm. I mean, I'm very glad I don't have to talk about the details of the legal arguments in the case, because it's a number of years on, and I tend to forget legal arguments in the case a couple of weeks after I've argued it.
But they were incredibly technical.
They were technical. Yeah. They were technical. But let me just give you some reflections a few years on of what I now take from the case. So I want to talk a little bit about why, a few years on, I now think why we won. And I just want to give a few reflections as to what that win means for what law can do and what human rights law can do and what the limits of human rights litigation in domestic courts are. So I jotted down 7 factors as to why I thought we won, but listening to Liora, I've added an 8th. And some of them are pretty basic, but the first and the foremost was actually because we had clients who showed unbelievable bravery and tenacity in bringing their claims. I mean, not just the 5 leads, but the veteran group who stood behind them. I mean, they were 5 just representative examples of a much larger group. And their bravery of keeping the issue alive and bringing the case to London was just, I mean, utterly inspiring. And that's obviously the main reason why it got to court. I mean, the second reason is much, but that's the primary reason, the rest aren't in order. I mean, another reason was just pure politics, Kenyan politics, that this was a claim, you know, the Mau Mau prescribed organisations sort of shortly before we brought the case. And so the realities of bringing it were such that it couldn't really have been brought before. A third reason, and a absolutely critical reason, was because of Caroline's work, primarily Caroline's work that brought it to light, and the work of other historians. But it was really Caroline that raised the issue, or not only raised the issue, but just dealt with it in this methodical way. Now, the case had actually, Martin Day had been approached prior to your book coming out, and I advised in that case for some time beforehand, and I don't think I'm waiving any form of privilege to say that it would not have gone on to being issued in 2009 unless we had had that type of marshalling of the historical evidence that we had from your work. The next reason, the fourth reason, was disclosure. I mean, that played a pretty vital role in both the first hearing to demonstrate that there was an arguable case, and also the second hearing was utterly crucial, which was demonstrating that a fair trial was possible, because what we were able to do because of disclosure, because primarily the Hanslake disclosure, and then Caroline and Dan's work on marshalling that material, is we were able to show that, you know, every record for this committee was still in existence, every record for that committee was still in existence. And because we tied that into the nature of our case, which was all about systems, rather than a case dependent upon the recollection of one individual or another, we were able to demonstrate that a fair trial was possible. But without that disclosure, we wouldn't have been able to do it. I mean, I don't know if I take a different stance from Caroline. I mean, I have no doubt the documents were hidden originally in Hanslake because they didn't want anybody to get hold of them. I don't think in the terms of the litigation anybody was seeking to hide them. I think the FCA and the legal department.
I don't want to give that impression. Yeah. The impression was that it was that they were hidden prior to the case, but certainly once the case happened. So thank you for clarifying.
That's the next factor. Without trying to schmooze anything, is this case could not have happened without Martin Day. The case cost hundreds of thousands of pounds. I mean, it was taken over and run by Dan, who, you know, life was taken over by it. And again, I don't think I'm waiving any privilege to say, when we first looked at the case, nobody thought we were ever going to get paid. But the clear message that Martin sent out, and that to me and to his own team, was this was going to be a case that had to be run as if we were being paid £1,000 an hour. And, you know, the amount of time that went into this case was extraordinary, and the amount of effort was just extraordinary. The next reason, the sixth reason, is because of the judiciary. And there are two aspects to that. One is we brought this case at a time in which the English judiciary has got a handle on human rights. So, you know, we were already well over a decade into the Human Rights Act. Lots of judges now understand what human rights are. It's on their radar. They feel more comfortable with dealing with it. they feel more comfortable with things to do with overseas, mm-hmm. you know, international law. I mean, this was the case, we tried to make it as simple as possible, but these are still the things that, you know, judges were geared up to do. So that was one aspect of it. And the other aspect of it, which was a very interesting one from an advocate's perspective, was we had a very conservative judge, a very traditional, very conservative judge, who I think ended up thinking it was the most interesting case he'd ever done, but that was certainly not how he started off. And I have no idea, but my very clear impression was when he first looked at this case, he thought it was a load of rubbish and was ready to just kick it out. And what he was a person who was just, when he started reading the evidence, was prepared to change his mind. And in both hearings, I remember a turning point where he looked at particular documents, and a deeply conservative man, I don't use that pejoratively, was just outraged. And there was one point in which I was taking him to a document which was all about the Kenyan Attorney General had essentially tried to kind of cover up a murder. And I was taking to the document and, you know, gently suggesting this was an Attorney General trying to cover up. And the judge slammed down his pen and said, "This is an outrage." And I was thinking, oh no, I've gone too far. What am I going to do? I was about to sort of go, well, when I say cover up. And he goes, an Attorney General. And he was just livid. And I don't think it was a judge who had ever thought that he was going to put a footnote in a judgment that said this was disgraceful behaviour in the shadow of the Holocaust. And so I think that's one of the other reasons. The seventh reason, before I come to the new one in light of what Liora was talking about, was that we kept it simple. We put in a very simple legal structure, as if this was just a straightforward personal injury case. And obviously, as you read the judgments, you can see one can't always keep it super simple, but that was our guiding principle that the legal team adopted. The eighth factor, which is the new one, which is I think the case did benefit from being a historical case. Mm-hmm. And I say that, you know, as someone who litigates cases now regularly to do with ongoing human rights abuses, rendition, torture, also litigated throughout the Iraq conflict and Afghan conflict. And so I've got a sense of just how reluctant even the most seemingly liberal of our senior judiciary can be, and how reluctant they can be to start getting involved. You know, if this were a case that had been brought about the current and ongoing mistreatment, you know, we wouldn't have had all these documents. They'd all been claimed, public interest immunity would have been claimed at best, more likely would be in a closed material proceedings. And so, you know, I found it fascinating, Laura, the kind of tension and conflict that you were talking about there. So I think all these went together. No one, I don't think any of them individually would have secured our case. But there was an almost perfect storm, I'd say, Dan, that allowed us to get, you know, two great court judgments and then the settlement. And that then takes me to my second kind of main reflection, which is, what does this really tell us about the role of human rights law, and what kind of lessons can one learn? I mean, this was a tort case, which is not a classic human rights tort. I mean, we often think about human rights in the context of public law, and certainly in terms of international human rights law. But this was a case in which tort law proved to be a very effective tool from a victim's perspective in human rights. And there are two main reasons for that. One in and of itself, because if you issue a claim in the High Court, you're going to get a hearing. And so it gave the client access to a court. And from a human rights perspective, that was incredibly important and powerful, because it gave a voice to the clients. I mean, they gave evidence. I mean, I have to say, to 20-something years of practice, it was the most extraordinary moment in court when we called our clients, and our first client came up, who was an elderly Kenyan who received the most appalling treatment. And we didn't know what line the Foreign Office were going to take, whether they were going to be cross-examined on the details of what occurred, and my opposite number stood up and made a statement, which was that they accepted that he was a victim of torture, and they weren't going to suggest otherwise. And in terms of just, you know, one of the most extraordinary moments in court, and incredibly valuable for our clients, not just the ones who gave evidence, but the wider group before, because here they are in the High Court of London, having been, I mean, you cannot think of anything more disempowering than being the victim of a foreign power who comes into your country, puts you into a camp, takes you out of your village, and tortures you. I mean, you know, it's hard to be more disempowered, and yet here they are, bringing the British government before their own British government courts, and they're up in a witness box and they're saying this is what occurred to us. And I thought that's an incredibly powerful way that tort law was used, but not least because it gave a record as well. It gave a record to what occurred in a public forum. Now, so that's one direct way that tort law was used effectively, I think, as a human rights tool. The other is an incidental. And again, that one is to make too many sub-paragraphs. There are two ways, at least two ways, in which the incidental power of tort law can work as a human rights tool. One is because it brought the issue to the public eye.
Mm-hmm.
And I started off this case, well, shortly after Martin's knock on the door of the hotel room in Nairobi, I got a telephone call from Martin going, what do you think? And, you know, I obviously, I'm an old-fashioned lefty, doesn't like colonial power, but I had no sense of what had gone on in Kenya, and I start every sort of case with a slight degree of scepticism. But here we are, producing a case that results for 4 days in a row in the front page of the Times, and 3 days in a row with leaders in the Times talking about the importance of the case. And that's, I think, I mean, not least from a kind of lessons learned sort of perspective, and obviously everybody forgets about it now, and Brexit, I think, was it Grayling talking about the lack of colonial, lack of stain on the UK colonial record, and we you know, the one lesson we learn from history is we never learn lessons. But for a moment in time, at least, we were forced to ask ourselves, what have we done as part of our past? And that was as a result of publicity, which in turn was a result of the tort action. The other important incidental aspect is it led to settlement. And what, as a lawyer, and again, I think Dan and I were very excited about this at the time, is that it kind of gave us an opportunity to think outside the box. I mean, obviously, if you're a tort claim, it's about compensation, which is, can be very important to victims, as it was for the victims here. But if you're on a settlement situation, you can start thinking more in terms of transitional justice. You can start thinking in terms of what it is that's going to help your clients come to terms with the past, move forward. So compensation, yes, but the apology was of immense importance to the clients, which was one aspect of the package. And the other important aspect of the package was that the UK were going to fund a memorial in Nairobi. And, you know, I kind of grown up doing transitional law stuff and kind of, you know, had memorial in my tick box of things, you know, lustration, memorial, tick, tick, tick. But we went out, a group of us, October to Nairobi for the unveiling of the memorial, which I had assumed was going to be, you know, a couple of dozen people, a little ceremony, or clap. The ceremony was due to start, I think, 10 o'clock. We walked from our hotel, which is in a central park in Nairobi, walked to our hotel with Dan and with a couple of others. And we come into this huge park, and there are 25,000 people there. And it is it's like a celebration, actually. And the importance of it, I mean, thousands and thousands of veterans, and the importance of it was, I mean, just so obvious to people as something concrete. You know, that was obviously not something the court could give, but it would not have happened but for the court case. Mm-hmm. And what I should say is, you know, obviously this was a case brought against the British government for appalling crimes against humanity, and they litigated this case for far too long. But once they had decided that they were going to settle this case, the FCA behaved, I thought, you know, absolutely exemplary. They were interested in traditional justice issues. I mean, in terms of what they did in preparing the memorial, and in terms of Hague's, who was a, not my party, but a qualitative difference from Miliband, in terms of I thought Hague again behaved in an exemplary fashion. So look, that's the other kind of takeaway that I take from this, which is that, you know, tort here could be used as a very effective human rights tool. And just to move to the kind of third and final observation, which is the overlap with kind of more contemporary cases. It's kind of plus la chance, plus la même chose, in the sense that, you know, with what all the dehumanisation that one sees with the UK overseas in a colonial setting. You see endless strands, whether it's the kind of mistreatment of detainees, whether it's getting involved with the Americans in the rendition program. You see that all again. That's why I think many of the tools that we used in Mau Mau, using tort law, also using public law, obviously, but again, keeping it simple, again, focusing on what the victims want, are tools that one can use in this modern age, but accepting, obviously, that law is a very blunt, very limited tool in the human rights context. There was a lovely quote in an article I read over the weekend which says that law is the justice to that which medicine is to mortality. Mm-hmm. You know, you can play around the edges a bit, but ultimately it doesn't get to the heart of it. So those are my reflections on the Mau Mau case.
I don't know about you, but I just wanted to hear more and more. What an extraordinary panel. Thank you very much. You will be aware this is a very unbalanced panel. We don't have a representative in the Foreign Office here, and I have been in obviously close communication with certain people in government. It is, of course, not possible for them to put someone in the panel when there's ongoing litigation. But I wanted to explain that. You will have sensed, of course, that there is a very missing part of the story here. With that, I'd like to throw it open in the time we have left. We also have drinks next door where we can hopefully continue the conversation in a more informal. So any questions? And could you identify yourself as well?
My name is Bronwyn Manby. I'm at the LSE level deal. I have a question about the issue of historical truth. And on the day when Jean-Pierre Bemba has been found guilty in the ICC, all panelists ready to reflect about the fact that this was the British courts finding Britain responsible, and the relative significance, therefore, of an international court finding somebody responsible, given all of the political tensions and so forth about the ICC, but also perhaps in the context of Brexit, the repeal of the Human Rights Act. I mean, I assume we aren't actually going to withdraw from the European Convention, but who knows? Anything is possible. Just that question about given that this is an argument about Britain's historical legacy, the significance of the cases being in the British courts, and therefore for other countries, the relevance of the ICC and what organisers think about that.
Panelists, can I invite you to take notes? Because I'm actually going to take as many questions as we can, and then we can discuss further. We'll have a brief time for answers, but I want to get some questions and comments out, if that's okay.
Thank you. I'm Clive Baldwin, Human Rights Watch, and thank you to all the panellists. What's striking coming from international human rights organisations is looking at some of these issues in the UK is how we're talking about some of the most serious international crimes, war crimes, crimes against humanity, torture, and yet there's virtually no prosecutions. And if there is, it's only at the most junior level, as in Northern Ireland. Do any of the panellists see a way to go forward from these tort claims into prosecuting those responsible for such crimes, either through litigation or even through calling historic crimes as they were and calling historic criminals as they were?
Do we have any other questions or comments before we turn?
Yeah. My name's Kevin Conroy, I'm a solicitor. There's another Kenyan case going on. There's recently been a hearing in the High Court. Given the fact that Kenyan won, as I call it, paper settled. Can the panel explain why Kenyan 2 isn't paper settled, bearing in mind that the government were happy to settle Kenyan 1? On that case, I think it was 20,000 claimants.
40,000.
40, there you are, double.
But before we throw it back to our panelists. Okay, now, we can throw those questions out. Brief comments.
Well, I'm not involved at all in the other Kenyan cases, so I have no idea on a granular level. I can anticipate, I think those cases are brought in quite a different way. They're broader. So it might give the Foreign Office considerably more scope for legal arguments to try and knock them out. I anticipate that, as with any defendants, any commercial, when they're facing commercial risks, they will be reluctant to give a signal that they settled for those particular reasons, having lost on those particular cases, that it's open season for colonial claims. And so I imagine that if they think they could fight them and win, then they will. Different considerations applied. That's purely his impression without actually knowing the details of those cases. On prosecutions, on Clive's point, there is no reason, as a matter of legal principle, why, if you establish in a tort claim that on the balance of probabilities, so and so committed these acts. Not as though there's no reason why criminal prosecution wouldn't flow. It would be on its face irrational of the Crown Prosecution Service applying its own evidential code not to prosecute. Mau-Mau is a little different because of the passage of time than that pretty much everybody, well, not everybody actually, but many of the main characters had died. I mean, there were some who were still alive, and the defendant tried to make a point that all these people in their 70s and 80s couldn't be relied on to give accurate evidence because they were in their 70s or 80s, to which we had great fun doing a list of judges who were still alive to be the arbitrators. If I understand your question, is it whether or not there is greater value?
Yes, I guess my question may be more addressed to Caroline, from the perspective of the victims, for example, as well. I mean, the value of this course being written, finding, there was a settlement, but the court nonetheless allowing the case to go forward.
I think it varies from case to case, because it almost mirrors the whole argument they had over the Statute of Rome as to whether or not you should prosecute in your own country if you possibly could, and then the international community will step in only if you can't or you won't. But actually, in the Mau-Mau case, I thought it was the right forum, and I think it was the right forum for our clients, which is, in terms of fingers up to the regime. I mean, I don't think it would have been the same if the Kenyan courts had said, well, the British were responsible, and then they gave an award that they could never enforce. I think the fact they were before the English court, who understandably saw Britain as globally as responsible, they were before those courts are giving the British government a hard time, those courts are vindicating their rights. I think in that case it had value. I don't think there is a general rule that you can apply though. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yes, just very briefly, I would fully agree with Richard on that point. I think in this, and I can only speak to this particular case, but based upon my knowledge, not just of the circumstances around the detention, but Kenyan history more generally, the idea of being a British subject, the notion, I was talking to somebody today, that the Queen's picture hung in every detention camp. They were singing God Save the Queen while they were being forced to labor. And so the idea of going to the Queen's court, the Queen's bench, back here was enormously symbolic, and I think you cannot underestimate, I think, the impact, whether it was an international court and certainly a Kenyan court, that it was, and I sort of keep coming back to monarchy and the Queen, but there's no sense of, remember, the Prime Minister is irrelevant to many sort of people from rural Kenya, but the Queen and the symbolic meaning of that, I think, it cannot be underestimated. To the question about Kenyan 1 and Kenya 2, I also am not involved in the case. I was asked to come on board, and I was largely declined because I have nothing further to add, to be honest. I mean, at this point, I've gone through, you know, my variety of submissions to the court are all available. I also, with Richard, to the limited degree that I am aware, it's a much larger scope, and some of that actually really is outside my expertise. I work on system, you know, we are fairly narrow often as academics, and so I worked on sort of systematic violence in detention camps and behind barbed wires, not on sort of, land alienation or the taking of cattle or property, or there are experts who work on that, but I do not, and that I think is sort of the expansive scope of this particular case, at least as I understand it. So
I don't have anything to say on the Kalian cases. I don't know, apart from the fact that I imagine if Caribus had come on board, there might have been another scenario. But I do have something to say about this notion of the symbolic. Symbolically, it would have been very important that it was an English court, but it's a very English judgment. I mean, you're absolutely right that that tort was the key there, because when you actually read through the Macomb's second judgment, he's completely dismissive of customary international law. He dismisses of jus cogens. He's kind of uncomfortable with the Human Rights Act material. That this was not a case that would have been won on the human rights grounds. And it's interesting when you read across from there to the KU case, where there's obviously much more engagement with the arguments around human rights. But again, it's going at these human rights cases, these human rights terms. I think Lord Kerr said in the judgment, you can't approach this in these kind of inflexible, rigid rules approach. And so, there's a different dynamic. You get a very particular take on human rights in that case. And he's really not interested in. So he's, as far as he was concerned, the human, you know, convention didn't help at all, and that it was about, you know, this was to do with this temporal restriction on cases you could bring. Mm-hmm. He was very quick to dismiss both of those grounds, and it was only on the tortious ground that I think that the case would have went forward.
Can I just build on that point very, very briefly, and that is the rule that is particularly the second approved judgment reminded me very much, and it gets also to Richard's point, that this was a conservative, and I mean that in a non-judgmental way, judge, where paternalism matters, right? And sort of the paternalistic ethos of empire. And if you read his judgment side by side with the parliamentary debate about the Hovell detention camps of 1959, and Enoch Powell, who is a Tory, is outraged in the same way that I can't believe an attorney general is, and in the same way that the Tory comes down and says, this is outrageous, we are violating our sort of paternalistic duty of care and responsibility in sort of that good Tory manner. And in that sense, once Richard was capable, and Philippa, of kind of crossing that Rubicon, of sort of playing to that sensibility, and anyway, this is just an historian's observation, it's very reminiscent of sort of the end of empire when it all comes crashing down with the Hovell massacre, and the greatest voice of outrage outside of Fenner Brockway and Barbara Castle on the very far left, and they're on the margins of the Labour Party, is the far right, are outraged that this should happen under Her Majesty's watch and empire. And so it's an interesting intersection again in terms of reading through some of this and the ways in which it can illuminate in part some of the contemporary questions that are being asked. And I think historians actually do have a lot to offer in these contexts. And as Richard was saying, historical cases have probably more traction. And I think that's also in part because you can read this evidence and history doesn't necessarily repeat itself. But I also think it's an archival issue. Historians are, by nature, archival rats. We love time. Like, we will sit and have a geek off for hours over who knows the archives better. And I think it's true. And I think that this becomes very important from a legal standpoint, because we really can read these files and documents and tell you precisely what you're missing, what's not there, what should be there, and can say with a high degree of certainty when all these migrated archives are released that this is bunk, that there should be more, and here's why. And that becomes extremely important in the legal arena when you're trying to reset the temporal clock on things, right? And so I think in that sense, this archival exercise becomes very much a legal exercise, but can only happen in the historical context because of the 30-year rule.
The clock says stop, but certainly the brain will keep going, looking at truth, whether through our historian brains, our legal brains, our journalist brains. through the lens of a glass of wine, if you will. Yeah. Next, thank you all for coming. Our next LSE Matrix seminar will be on the 5th of May with Louis Moreno Ocampo, the first prosecutor of the ICC, Gary Simpson and Professor Ruji Tytel on the trial of the Hunters. Hope you'll join us. Thanks.